Click here to subscribe our channel and do not forget to press the bell icon to get regular updates of our videos. Hello friends, good morning to all of you. So I am back with another video on sociology optional subject for UPSC CSE means examination. In this video we are going to see the perspective of Henri Beteille on the study of caste system. So friend, please do these 3 hours. It will really motivate me to continue this awesome course. Share as much as possible so that more and more people will get benefited. Comment and like the video and ask any doubt if you have. And now you can also follow us on every page, that is facebook.com/unorthodoxacademy. So friend, as you know that we are covering slot 3, that is stratification, caste and class. We have finished paper 1, topic 5th. In paper 2, we are covering caste system. So in this video, we are going to see the perspective of Henri Beteille on the caste system. So Henri Beteille is basically also known as the Indian Max Weber because he applied the concept of Trinitian model of Max Weber on the Indian caste systems. And the Trinitian model of Max Weber says that there are three things in the social stratification, that is caste, status group and party. So here in his book Caste, Class and Power, here caste refers to the status group, class means class or the stratification with respect to the class or basically in terms of economics, and the third one is party, that is the power here. So basically he tried to understand the Indian caste system with respect to the time, and here time refers to the time before the British rule, during the British rule and after the British rule. So for that he studied the Srirampuram village of South India, and he tried to understand the relations of caste with class and power and their changing relations. So as with respect to the time, the class or basically the relation between caste, class and power changed, and basically they lead to the phenomena of social stratification. It leads to the changes in the social stratification. So for in Srirampuram village of South India, he sees the different three relations of stratification before the British rule, and in first he said that the caste, the Brahmins are basically the landlords at that time, and they are have the dominant class, whereas the non-Brahmins were the basically peasants, or they are intermediary or having less power than the Brahmins. And there is a third caste, that is Adi Dravids, that is they are basically sharecroppers or landless farmers, and they are powerless at that time. So basically during the British rules there are a lot of caste movements that are going to happen because due to the democracy, modern occupations, modernization and westernizations, and the ideology that are bring by these phenomena will lead to the changes in relation between the caste, class and powers, and therefore the relations on between these three things, that is caste and class, basically based on the permutations and combinations. And then Henri Beteille believed that during British rules and afterwards the inequality in the powers will change. So basically first we see that what is the scenario or relations between caste and class, caste, class and power before the British or the pre-British era. So at that time caste may be defined as a small and named group of person which is characterized by endogamy, hereditary memberships and having a specific style of life, which sometimes include that pursued by the traditionals, or we can say during the pre-British era, the basically it is can be said as traditional Indian society, and it is usually associated with more or less distinct rituals status in the hierarchical system. So there are very rituals which is in the part of hierarchy systems at that time, and the caste system basically at that time enjoyed both legal and religious sanctions in the traditional society, because at that time caste is an important phenomena and caste determined various things in the society. So there at that time different castes were assigned different rights on the basis of their hierarchy, on the basis of their status in the hierarchy system of caste systems, and at that time there is no inference or influence of the economic matters, and not only in economics matters, but they have over a wide range of social phenomena. And basically in traditional society, punishments were different on the basis of, not on the basis of nature of offense committed, but also according to the caste of the offender. So for example, if a same crime is committed by Brahmins and Adi Dravids or non-Brahmins, so the punishment that they are going to give to these will also differ on the basis of the caste they are having. So basically in Srirampuram, important decisions were concerning that were concerning to the village were whole, or the decisions were taken largely by Brahmins, and non-Brahmins played some part in implementing these decisions, because we know that non-Brahmins or if we consider Kshatriya, they are having the authority of governing, and the Adi Dravids had very little say, or almost there is no influence of Dravids on the matters related to the punishments or the decisions. So basically classes as such are not defined at that times, and as you know that there are three classes that if we consider in general, that is upper, middle and lower. So at that time there is not much definitions or there is defined classes. So basically classes are defined on the terms of property of ownership, because it can be said as the economic phenomena, and the on the non-ownership of the means of production. So at that time property by itself does not create social honor. So if you have a lot of property, so it will not going to influence your status in the hierarchy of caste systems, although it is generally a precondition to it. So thus when a Velela, that is the intermediary caste, acquires land, he does not automatically move in the scale of social honor, or we can say in the status group, or we can say that he will not going to achieve social mobility. So for this he required, in addition to sensitize his style of life, that is he has to imitate the norms and value of the Brahmins. So basically class is in principle and to an extent in practice were open as compared to caste, because we can generally say that class is an economic phenomenon, and if you are in the middle class and if you acquire a lot of land and economic achievement in terms of economics, then you will lead to the mobility to the upper class. So one may change one's position from tenant to landowner, or from agricultural laborer to owner cultivator. So whereas one cannot, however, change itself from a Velela into a Brahmin, or from Pala into a Velela. So the free mobility, which is in principle permitted within the class systems, is in reality limited by the various factors, we can say. And thus the son of a rentier has much greater chances of himself becoming a rentier than the son of an agricultural laborer. So it is, however, not impossible for the latter to become a land owner. So basically it affects the social mobility and the movements upwards or downward within the caste systems. In theory, we can say inadmissible, and also although there are some movements in practice. So then Beteille observed how Kellas transformed themselves into Marawas and Ahmadiyyas into Velas. So yet there are significant difference between social mobility in the caste system and social mobility in the class system. So it is much easy to move in the upwards or downward in the class systems, but this is not possible in the caste system. So in the latter, it is the individual who moves up or down, whereas in the former, entire communities changes their position. So for example, if in class systems, it is the whole community that are going to change, but in the latter, it is the individual who moves or up or down. So now we see the transformations in the caste, class and power during the British rules and the afterwards. So basically in today's time we can say that there are certain amount of divergence between the hierarchy of caste and that of class. So both the systems have been undergoing some modification, or we can say a lot of modification, because of the new ideologies that are came because of the British rules and the during the connectivity in the world. So Because of the general trend towards westernization and secularization, the class and the class system, because of the extension of cash economy, we can say it will directly lead it due to the extension of cash economy and because of the land which having come into the market. So that's why the fast changes have taken place in the distribution of powers, and now power has shifted much more decisively from the traditional elite of village into the hands of new popular leaders. So that's why the power distribution is changes, and we can say it affected also because of now because of these ideologies and democracy. And here the majority, or we can say the number of persons matter, or we can say it is a numerical strength matters here. So now we see the what are the reasons in the transformations that lead it to the different relations between these phenomena. So basically, due to introduction of democracy and political modernizations in the today political power, whether in the village or outside, it is not as closely tied to the ownership of land as it was in the past. So now there are some new bases that are emerged of power, which are some to extend independent of both caste and class. So here the caste and class not matters in the present time. Perhaps most important among these is the strength, or we can say the numerical strength or numerical support from the society. Now today power is no longer a monopoly of any single caste in the village. It has to some extent detached itself from caste, and one has how now to consider the balance of power between caste or group of castes. So basically there is a lot of influence of the adult franchise which is bringed because of the democracy. So this balance is unstable in nature, and the factors other than caste play an important role in maintaining it and changing it from day to day. So in addition to caste and class, there are important focus of power which being specifically to the domain of politics. So emergence of such focus, as we see that by the things that is panchayat systems, parties and the political networks, has largely been a feature of the political modernizations of India. And the popular leaders of the village today are not necessarily big land owners, and the panchayat president, who is a key figure in the village politics, owns some land, but this is not his principal source of power. His power basically depends upon a plurality of factors, among which his contact with politicians and party bosses outside the villages and his position in an elaborate system are important ones. So basically we can say plurality factors may be said as the vote bank which a person is holding. It neither depends on his economic perspective, neither it is based on his caste which he belong to in the society. So these are the factors that lead to the changes in the phenomena of these or the relations between these factors. So now we see the two factors that have contributed in a big way to change the distribution of power specifically in the village. So the first of these is the decline in the influence of old mirasdars, that is we can say the landlords class, for a variety of reasons, and we can say basically introductions to the new ideologies and awareness in the people. And the second is the growth of an elaborate political machinery linking MLA party bosses and village leaders, and making it possible for people to acquire power in ways which were not open before the introduction of adult franchise and the Panchayati Raj. So that's why, or we can say these are can be said as the pluralistic factors that affected the power distributions in the society. So now we see the emerging leaders of village are thus not members of old land owning class. They generally belong to the class of small owners, all the cultivators. Their power is to a large extent basically based on the numerical support, which is mostly affected due to the political system. So basically political systems or democratizations depend on the numerical support, or we can say the majority and minority within the village and political context outside it. So these two factors tend to reinforce each other. So now we can also say that there is not much relationship between the Brahmins and the Adi Dravids, whereas the non-Brahmins and Adi Dravids has a good relations because of the factors as the Brahmins were tried to maintain their purity, and additionally the members of old Mirasdas class feel ill at ease in the face of changes in the ideological climate and the introduction of democratic forms of government, and more particularly of adult franchise, has created in the minds of people a new consciousness of their own political importance irrespective of caste, class and other social factors. So villages, however, which has lower social or economic positions, have now by had the experience of being courted during elections by important political personalities from towns and cities. So the support of masses can no longer be taken for granted, and in this matter the new political leaders, the contact men, have an edge over the Mirasdas, who are basically the old land lords. So basically there is always a certain barrier which deters the old Mirasdas from preaching his tenants or servants for vote, is an attitude of supplication, that is prayer. So there is a sense of pride which keeps him from competing for popular support with people who had till recently taken his superiority for granted. So basically, on the other hand, we can say that the new non-Brahmin leaders have an advantage over him in this regard because of the contacts with the because the non-Brahmins have the more contact in day-to-day life with the Adi Dravids, whereas Brahmins were tried to make themselves sacred, and they are not having the good contact with the Adi Dravids. So nowadays the skill to organize people have become an important factor. The distribution of power has acquired a very dynamic character over the last few decades, and in some ways we can say the traditional relationship between caste and powers is reversed, or we can say fully changed, whereas in the past power were considered in the Brahmins. But that today, due to the village panchayat will having the more control by which in the village panchayat the controls is more influenced, or the power is more influenced by the non-Brahmins, and the traditional elite is being pushed into the background, and thus we can say that a change from a static society to the change, there is a lot of change in the static and compared to traditional social order to a more dynamic one, and the economic and political system will be playing a major role, and basically they detach themselves from caste and acquire a relatively autonomous characters. So here the power will change with respect to time, with great changes in day-to-day life, and the intermediary caste, because of their numerical strengths, mobilizes themselves and replace Brahmins from the power. So as you know that in democracy there is a much lot influence of the numerical strength because of the majority and minority votes. So we can say the vote bank. Now we see the criticism. So basically he studied a perspective that sound more relevant in South Indian societies, where lower caste required social mobility in comparison to other parts of India, but in North India still lower class and powerless also, and this perspective cannot apply on every caste in all the part of country. Still Marxist analysis or perspective of economic determinism sound relevant in feudalistic rural society of North India, where those who control the economic powers control the aspects of life. As we can see, there is a lot of difference between North India and South India, and the dominance of caste are determined by rituals in many parts of society. Hence it cannot be said that the three dimension, that is status group, class and party, from the Trinitian model of Max Weber of the Indian society can be studied independently, and there is not much relations between these. Now we see the conclusion. So basically Henri Bettel is a contemporary sociologist who tried to apply the Weberian's three-dimensional model on the Indian society. So unlike other sociologists, Henri Bettel studied caste system in the context of changes that occurring during British period and onward, and we seen these changes, and his predecessors tries to understand the caste system in the static forms. That means they are seeing the static characteristics of caste systems and its characteristics, whereas the Henri Bettel tried to understand it from the changes, or basically from the dynamic perspective, due to the democracy, occupations, urbanization, industrialization, westernizations, and is still his three-dimensional, that is caste, class and power perspective, sound to be relevant because the modern factors and influence the caste systems, and truly now the relation between caste and class power has separated and they are trying to influence each other, rather determining each other. So we can say that in today Indian society, it is largely coming out of the influence of the caste systems, and today is no guarantee that individual will get a position in class and power by the virtue of their caste. But yet there are some few places which may be sound not applicable to this perspective, but as the modern factors are changing, Indian villages is also going to change, and Henry Beteille perspective sounds more relevant than the other perspective. So thank you guys for listening and watching this video. Thank you.